glad you're all here, because last week I mentioned to the group how poor my country Tis of Thee was getting. We're getting pretty weak. So glad the numbers are here to help back that. We'll start with the 50-50 drawing if we're ready. Getting there? Okay. Oh yeah, we'll do a quick introduction first. We've got the Warsaw Inner Club group here. If you guys would like to introduce yourselves.
Yeah, from Warsaw we have Darren Miller, Dick Dobbins, Don Bergen, and I'm Lee Hall.
All right, glad you guys can make it.
I have a guest, Terry Webb. I think everybody knows it.
We ready?
Yes, oh. I have a guest, Bill Kintig. He's family from here, but now he has moved to Rochester from Illinois. So. All right.
Val has a guest as well.
Val? Do you have a guest as well?
Oh, excuse me, yes. I have my son Jim Pemberton with me. I'll introduce the guy sitting down next to me. This is Roger Rose.
Brian, are you ready?
Yeah. Okay. Linda says we have $18. We'll let the mayor draw. No pressure. So remember, you can only make one person in this room happy with this.
Okay. Is this a scratch off? Okay. We are looking at 8:43.
Are you kidding, Mason?
No pollution here.
Anybody trying?
We did. It checks out. So
we're tearing it up. All right. Now. Yes.
Happy dollars.
Here's some happy dollars for everyone here today.
I'm gonna head back to Eldon here while everybody else grabs theirs.
Happy to see so many here, and I have to see if I can go back next week to speak to you again.
And I may do that just to see if the Warsaw guys come every week for a free lunch. They were here the last time I spoke.
It's not free.
Oh, okay.
I'm happy my speaker showed up. Thank you.
Happy New Year. That's good.
Vi's got one back here.
My nephew, who I haven't seen in 27 years, stopped by and spent the night last night.
Thank you for the mayor and the entourage.
How many did you put in there?
All right, is that everyone? All right, before we get going, I'd like Ron Smith to come up, please.
Okay.
Not sure if you know this, but you've been a Kiwanian for 45 years now.
Oh, so my gosh. I didn't even know I was that old.
He's got a... Okay.
I'm here today. We got a good crowd today.
Good.
Thank you for the way of coming over.
Yep.
Okay. Thank you, Tammy.
We will have Brian introduced the guest today.
Well, we're pleased to have Ted Denton, the mayor of Rochester, with us today. This year, we gave him a whole year to prepare. Last year, I called him in January and said, the mayor normally speaks at the end of the month, so we're expecting twice as good of a speech today. But Ted has been the mayor for just over a year in Rochester. Prior to that, had also served on the city council. Has also, in past careers, been very involved with Marshall Electric and a number of other companies in the community, and has really brought about some changes and developments within the community, been very involved in some things such as, personally, I know he's been involved in economic development areas much more so than in the past. So, and I know he's brought a lot of people with him to the meeting today. So I'll let you introduce the folks that are here. And with that, help me welcome Ted Denton to Kiwanis.
Hi, thank you, Brian. Thank you, Kiwanis members, distinguished guests, WROI, RTC, the Rochester Sentinel, and
Shopper's Guide.
Thank you, Gloria. Welcome, everyone. Welcome, community. That's what we are. Brian's right. There are a lot of folks here that are guests of mine today. Some of them I will be acknowledging, but all of them are very important, both city and county, because one thing we all figured out this last year, several of the county folks will tell you the mayor attended county council meetings, and last night we had about four members of county officials who attended city council meeting. What we found out is this isn't city and county. This is community, and we're all in this boat together. So we've been moving forward in a lot of ways in that boat together this last year. Isn't that correct, Sheriff? Am I not right? We're together a lot, and it's really beneficial. You need to know, the left hand needs to know what the right's doing. So I'm very happy that that has been one thing that's happened. The state of Rochester, exciting. Lots of things are happening in Rochester. Lots of people are getting involved. Lots of young people are getting involved. Cripe, we've got a city councilman now who just started shaving a couple weeks ago. And he's been a great addition to our city council, Councilman Heidi. But no, it's very, very exciting. This last weekend, I had the privilege of going over to Fort Wayne to watch the Fort Wayne Symphony. And you know, this is the group that the Sciotes, Helen Inyart, to bring over here every Christmas for the Holiday Pops. Well, I went over to see one of their other concerts, and oh my gosh, it was fantastic. And Maestro Caleb Young, who was here in December, led the orchestra, and they did just a wonderful two-hour program. Time just slipped by. But one thing I noted while it was all going on, Maestro Young never played the first note of music. Nothing came out of him that you could sell for entertainment. He walked out, jumped up, took a baton like this, and took about 100 very accomplished musicians and played some great, great music for 2 hours. That's all a good mayor does. I didn't do anything this last year that did anything to physically advance Rochester. Lenny, how many holes did I get out and dig? Huh?
Zero.
Well, I thought you'd give me a little credit. If Terry Lee were here, he would tell you I did climb down the big hole at 9th and Main Street a few times, but as far as actually doing anything, the mayor doesn't do that. He takes the baton and he gets up and he takes these very accomplished musicians and tries to play some very good music. And I'm happy to say that I think we've got an orchestra that is better than most. The people, last year I told you, after being in office for 3 weeks and standing here talking to you, the people that I'd come in contact with at the city was our most important asset. We did have a lot of nice equipment, a lot of assets that have been purchased, but our people, in my mind, were the most valuable. Well, I'm here to tell you, after working with them for a year, That was very, very true. And if I don't tell you anything else today, I want everybody to walk out of here with this. I'm very proud of every one of them. And a lot of them are here today. We had for the year a 4-foot by 8-foot cork bulletin board in the mayor's office that when I went into the office, it was full of maps. We took that down and we put Wall of Pride at the top of it. And anything and everything that our folks did over the year that made the new Sentinel, or anybody sent notes in thanking or appreciation of anything, we put on that wall. Chief Andy Schatz and Chief Tom Butler. By the way, where's Chief Butler? Stand up, will you? Has this man got pride written all over him? Seriously. That's what it's all about. These gentlemen came up with a swearing-in ceremony for new police officers and new firefighters, and we had one firefighter we took through the swearing-in ceremony. We had two police officers. Dan Stiles was our new fireman. Elaney Schroff and Ben Wood were our two new officers. Took them through a swearing-in process in the chamber with the mayor present and my two distinguished Board of Works members who are here today. Rick Figlio and John Little were both present. And then there was a signing of a certificate, and that went on the Wall of Pride along with pictures. And then we had the chief, Fire Chief Butler, coming to me and saying, you know, we've got a great volunteer fire department, and right now if a volunteer fireman wants a Class A uniform like the chief is wearing today, which they wear when they go to ceremonies like a funeral or a valet parking for the prom, any place where you've got a ceremonial situation, the chamber swearing in a new fireman, you know, there were 3 or 4 of our firemen there in their Class A uniforms. Our volunteers wouldn't be able to participate. They'd wear their blue work shirt in and such. I said, no, that doesn't work. I said, we don't have anybody but Class A firemen. So now our Class A firemen have those uniforms. But it's Chief Butler bringing that to my attention. The first thing I did when I walked into the mayor's office, walked in and noted, this was absent. We now have a flag in the mayor's office that I purchased out of my own pocket because it's my flag. Chief Butler came in with a flag spreader and showed me how to present it and make the flag work. Chief Butler and Chief Schatz and all of the team, they're all about red, white, and blue. We start every chamber meeting with the pledge now. That never used to be done. We start every Board of Works meeting with the pledge now. That never used to be done. We start every park board meeting with the pledge. We start every meeting in that chamber with the Pledge of Allegiance. It's about an attitude. And I've got some great people that are carrying all of that forward. Some other folks I'd like to recognize today is the superintendent of our water department, Derek Halderman, who's seated over here to my left. Derek. Fine young man who has shown me that, boy, there's a lot of potential sitting right there, management potential. His expertise in planning and people skills have been exceptional this year, to the point where in combination with a water board led by Derek, we're able to state that water rates are going to be held for at least the next 2 years. We didn't know that going into this last year. We thought, okay, the Dean's Melt thing's going to hit us hard somewhere along the line here, but it's only been through very, very good management principles and such that those things have been able to be kept in check. Tom over there, I just mentioned Chief Butler. He was very privileged, as the mayor was, to recognize three of our volunteer firemen this year for bravery. We had Justin Melton. We had Craig Smith and finally Dave Lawson, who were recognized, honored on TV and radio for some heroic efforts that every fireman doesn't get into. They served us well this last year, and they were recognized for it. Chief Schatz, stand up, Chief, will you? Chief, your mother's calling. No, that's not a phone call for the chief. Chief Schatz, I was greatly pleased to find that he was very anxious and willing to embrace the motto to protect and to serve. First thing we did, first week in office, we brought all the patrol cars into the parking lot and brought our folks in who do the stenciling, and we threw to protect and to serve back on the patrol cars and started talking to our officers daily about that motto and what that meant and how we wanted to be ambassadors for the community. The chief is going through the leadership academy. First time a police chief's ever done that in Rochester. It's first time I can think of any of the city folks doing that. I may be wrong, but Chief Schatz is going through it. And he's not only meeting people and getting to know the community of Rochester, different people, but they're getting to know him. Aren't they, Andy? You betcha. He's been instrumental in fighting crime in Rochester this year, carrying forth the mantra that the Citizens Action Committee started on the pseudoephedrine control and the meth production. It's just led to other things that have improved. Andy presented some statistics to us at the Board of Works meeting the other night, and we've got like six major areas that have been reduced as far as crime situations in Rochester from 2015. There's a good movement going there. Our officers are still never know when the mayor or one of the Board of Works members is going to ride along with them. I did a ride along this New Year's Eve. Yeah, it's pretty pathetic when all the neighbor or mayor's got to do on New Year's Eve is ride around the patrol car. But you know what? On New Year's Eve, I found out it is a lot better to ride in the front of that patrol car than it is the back of that patrol car.
Are you speaking from experience?
No. I've just been told. I've watched a lot of film. And the two Board of Works members can tell me. What you find out is what makes an officer tick when you're in that car with him for 4, 5, 6 hours, or her. And it's good stuff, because we've got some good people working out there now. We actually haven't had anybody resign for a while. Things seem to be cooking very well. Part of that is we're taking a new approach, trying to hire people who have roots in our community. And our latest hires, Ben Wood and Eleni Schroff, are both members of the community. Ben lives over on Park Road, owns a home, has a wife and children. Ben's going to be around here a while. Eleni is hometown girl. And boy, what a character and what a blessing we have to have Eleni. They're both doing great in the academy, by the way. And when are they going to be back, Chief?
February 16th.
They will be very active then, after February the 16th. But they've been around. And the thing about Eleni, you see her uptown in uniform or whatever, and there's always two or three women around her. And that's been very good. Very good for the community. We've had kids come in and want to do internships, not only with the police department, but the city. And speaking of the administrative side of the city, my right-hand person, it's like Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, is our clerk treasurer, Shada Beeler. Where's Shada? Stand up. We've gotten pretty close, haven't we? Yeah, yeah. I mean, and you know, that's good because one side of the office can't work without the other side of the office. It's just impossible. And, you know, I tend to be that marketing type, as Brian mentioned, and Shada's that numbers type who keeps us marketing types from falling off the face of the earth. Right, Val? Remember how that is?
Right.
You got to hang on to those marketing folks, don't you? Yeah. But no, I've been very, very pleased and fortunate to say that she's become a very good colleague, as well as her staff, Carolyn Gray, Tina Rowe, and Chris Bryant, all very, very valuable people up there and doing a very, very good job. Another one of the lieutenants that I work with daily, Lenny Conley. Lenny, you want to stand? Lenny's a street superintendent, and if you notice, I mentioned Derek and Lenny's titles as superintendents. They used to be supervisors. Well, they're not supervisors, they're superintendents. They're doing a great job. They're leading people. They're coming up with business plans for their departments. They're presenting at meetings. I know several of you have told me that who watch the city council meetings on Channel 4. They only tune in to see Lenny get up and give a presentation because we never know. We never know exactly what Lenny might say, right, Lenny? But he does a great job. Sitting down and looking at things academically, we had problems over the past getting the leaves picked up in a timely fashion. Well, you got so many resources. We sit down and take a look at the city divided up into sections. Lenny came up with a program of here's how we're going to attack this. And by the way, the secret is stay in the course. And things just start to work. So good job. I'm very fortunate to have Lenny around. We got Lyle Lingenfelder sitting over here, our golf pro. Stand up, Lyle. Lyle is kind of an unsung hero. He, you know, when you think of the city, you don't normally think of the golf pro popping up and being part of the city, but he's definitely a valuable part of the team. The golf course is one of the jewels of our city, along with the lake and the airport, and it's something that we want to highlight. Several of the businesses in town, of course, fit into that category also, but the golf course is brings people from out of town. Any of you guys from Warsaw play golf?
Not anymore.
Not anymore. Okay. All right. That's kind of how I play. Yeah. But no, we have lots of folks from out of town come, and Lyle has done a great job of making a municipal course into one that, you know, is just about as good as you can find anywhere. So I thank Lyle. Appreciate that. That pretty much covers everyone except for the last guy who's been around for a while. His name is Warren Leese. Warren, would you like to stand up? I snicker because Warren is kind of the go-to guy who has been the historian and everything and has really, really helped a new mayor make the transition. Sit down with Warren and say, well, now, Warren, what if we go ahead and do this and this and this? Well, you know, Mayor Ted, last time this came up, here's what happened. Oh, my gosh, great. You just kept me from running back into the minefield. Thank you. No, he's been very, very valuable. Once a week, the Curly, Larry, and Moe team, made up of Warren, Lenny, and the mayor, get in that little white truck and drive all over Rochester making notes about things that need to be addressed. And we've done that just about a whole year. There have been very few weeks when we haven't been able to do that, and Warren's been very valuable in that. Warren is our keeper of the lights, too, by the way. The street lights and everything, that has been a zoo, hadn't it? Came into office, we had 40 lights that were out in the community. Duke, some time ago, went from the local people taking care of things to a contractor, and it just takes so long. Well, Warren has jumped on that, and between the two of us working, we've got a pretty good handle on that now. But just things like that you've got to have somebody to rely on. Now, Warren has told me, he said, I have hit the age where I'd like to retire, at least semi-retire. So this next year, he's going to center his attentions just for the waste treatment plant, which is his expertise. He has all the credentials for the waste treatment plant, and he's going to work about half-time for us. And the title of operations manager is going to go away, and those duties will be absorbed by the mayor. But he'll still be around to get his brain picked and stuff, and we'll be operating a wastewater treatment plant on a daily basis. So, sounds like a vacation, doesn't it, after what you've been through, huh? Yeah. You know, he said the one part of his job that over the years that he hasn't appreciated is the telephone calls, right?
Yeah,
because when you're the operations manager and the mayor, his line is busy or whatever, who do you call? You call Warren. And a lot of times those people aren't happy, are they? Well, I thank you, Warren. Thank you very much. Terry Lee's not here today. Terry's our FEDCO director. He's at a meeting up in South Bend involving our regional involvement in the community. I don't see Amy Rowe here today. Amy's not here today, at least she had a commitment also. But one of the first economic development ventures we tackled, Amy and Terry and I, with the help of Scott Sager, Channel 4, Scott Sager, RTC, put together a PowerPoint selling Rochester. And we took that PowerPoint after making some cold calls to Warsaw. Had an appointment with the OrthoWorks group and got to meet Cheryl Connolly, the president of the OrthoWorks group, and some of her colleagues, and make an hour presentation on Rochester. Had folks sitting there in that group saying, I didn't know that about Rochester. I didn't know that was going on in Rochester. Where is this? We'd never done that before. Well, now they know who we are. And we've seen them a few times since then. Some of them have been here. Some of them really like Schnabeltier, and some of the ladies really like Flirt. We keep getting the reports back. Part of that process, that cold calling process, you know, it's interesting. The mayor can make a cold call and can get past the switchboard operator just by saying it's the mayor. That cold calling process helped me get to a fellow that has become a very good friend, a billionaire by the name of Tobias Buck. Toby owns Paragon Medical up in Pearson. And he's truly a billionaire. He owns 10 divisions of Paragon. Just opened his latest one January 1st in Italy. Paragon does private label manufacturing for all the orthopedic companies. So you get a Biomed elbow, it may have been made by Paragon. So he's been at it for 25 years and is a real solid American. When I got to meet him and he heard the story about Rochester, he was all over it. He said, I'm all for rural America. We've got to preserve rural America. By the way, he thinks the last election was a hoot because rural America stood up and said, stop, in his words, no more. And he thinks that's great because he says rural America made this country. I happen to believe he's right on. And he has told us, listen, I love what you're doing. You need a man in Warsaw. I'm your man in Warsaw. I'll help you. And that was proven back in September when one of our letters that we'd sent over to Illinois attracted the attention of a fellow in East Peoria who's had a business there for 50 years who wants to get out of Illinois. Been over here a couple of times, has been over to the industrial park to look at it. His wife has been here once, and we took him up. He's in the CNC business. They make all sorts of parts. Their biggest customer is Caterpillar, but he wanted to get in the orthopedics business. So we took him to meet Toby. And Toby committed to help him become a vendor to Paragon. So Bob asked me to come back and speak next Wednesday. Well, next Wednesday I'm going to have to pass on because I'm going to be in East Peoria with Terry talking talking to this gentleman about where we would put him in the industrial park out here. So we continue to move things like that forward. But the point is, these people just don't fall out of the sky. You got to go get them. And we've got this movement going in Rochester, this excitement, and we're moving forward with those kinds of things. I stood at 9th and Main a year ago and looked north down the main street of Rochester, saw a blue tarp and a hole at 9th and Main, saw some boarded up windows and some buildings and stuff, saw a lot of vacant buildings. Well, you know, happy to say you've got to do that every once in a while and then look over your shoulder, because I did it again then just the other day. And now at 9th and Main, I see the nice brick wall. I see the lot filled in. I see a lot of activity with our buildings downtown. We've got the Chamber and the Downtown Development Group led by Sarah Reese and Amy Rowe working on the facade program. We've got people like Casey Coles working with folks every day to make building improvements, and we have people making investments downtown. This time next year, our downtown's going to look even better, I guarantee it. But things are starting to happen, which we are very, very happy to see. I don't want to miss anyone here. Let me check down my list real quick. Basically, this board I told you about that I had in my office all year long, ended up the end of the year, it looked like the bulletin board down at the laundromat. It was packed. You know, we had lots of good, didn't we? Had lots of good stuff. Everybody who'd come in to see the mayor would stop and go through this board. Well, I had one section of it that was devoted to what I think was the most important and most valuable thing for our community to happen last year that I had the privilege of being involved with by becoming mayor. February the 1st of last year, the City Council and the County Commissioners, for the first time in the history of the community, met in session together under one roof, one chamber room, to sign a piece of legislation that has been historical. It was the pseudoephedrine ordinance, both county and city, the restriction of pseudoephedrine sale by the pharmacies in the community in an effort to cut the meth production that had been escalating in our community. I mean, we were number 3 for meth lab production, this county in the state of Indiana. I was very privileged to be part of that group to lead the meeting. And we had Commissioner Rose, whose signature is on that piece of legislation. Roger, would you like to stand, please? And I don't think any of the other colleagues are here, but the other one was Brian Lewis and Sherry Fulton were the other two commissioners who stood side by side with the City Council and signed that piece of paper. And several of the council members are here today who signed that ordinance. Councilman Heidi, would you please stand? Yep. I'm looking over the group. Councilman Smith, how could I miss you? Anyone else from the City Council here today? Well, okay. I got two out of the 6 who were actually there. One of our council members were absent. But it was very monumental. What was also monumental and historical was that this came about 3 years ago through the actions of a citizens group, Citizens Action Committee. And I just loved it. Because, you know, like rural America standing up during the election, we had citizens of the community standing up and saying, number 3 on meth lab production in this county is unacceptable, and we say no more. And by gosh, their voice was very strong. It led to our local ordinances being put in place when the state was doing something else. I mean, we were going against the state laws. We were making our own ordinances above and beyond what the state was doing. So we were pretty restrictive here when you could go in the state and operate elsewise. But that persistence and that starting here in Fulton County ended up resulting in Senate Bill 80 being passed in July, making it a state mandate, which was very similar to our ordinances here in the community. Our ordinances were basically the pattern for that that legislation. And of course, we know Senator Randy Head was very instrumental in leading that charge with the group here, and culminated with now Vice President Pence, who was then Governor Pence, coming to Rochester and signing that ordinance in Harry Webb's drugstore, Main Street. Very historical time, and I think the best thing that we did this last year. Well, that Citizens Action Group that I would like to recognize was Chairman Val Pimperton. He was the one who got things started 3 years ago, got in everybody's ear, came out to my office at Marshall Electric, and remember that day, Val, and said, you know, how can we get this going with the city? And I sent him to you, Councilman Smith. Councilman Smith and I have been down a lot of trails together. I said, that's the man you want right there. But he had a heck of a fireball committee. One of the people that got involved very, very early was Harry Webb. He's pretty tenacious, isn't he, Harry?
He is.
He doesn't let you go to lunch, no. Does he? I know. I know. I know. Harry, very valuable and instrumental in making trips to the State House and such, and leading the charge with the druggists, which all of them were pretty receptive, weren't they, really, when you got down to it?
Yeah, the individuals were, the corporations weren't.
Well, yeah, we know about corporations, but the grassroots folks were all about it, yeah. Because they knew it was the right thing to do. You know, people could go into a drugstore and tell the druggist they wanted a red box of pseudoephedrine, right? Which was a street slang for everything I can get, right? A whole bunch of it. You knew that person wasn't fighting a cold. The druggist knew it. Now, they're restricted. Dick Belcher, another valuable member of the community, the committee. Sheriff Chris Sailors, who's here today. Stand up, Sheriff. Chris was not only active on this committee, but after a city council meeting a few weeks ago, he and Chief Schatz have volunteered to be the mayor's personal bodyguard. Appreciated having the sheriff around that night with the chief. Another very, very active supporter on that committee was Senator Bob Peterson. Senator Peterson, would you stand, please? Thank you. And another one was Gloria Carvey. Gloria, stand, stand. No, 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 you don't get to leave. All right, all right. And I don't see him here today, but Mark Williamson was also part of that committee. As was Councilman Mark Smith. Marty, take a bow. And finally, Jim Bryant, another retiree who'd worked at Biomet for years, got involved and said, hey, not in my community. We're not going to do this anymore. This group pulled together and made it all happen. Guys, take it back to Warsaw. It's really a chapter in history that lots of folks could benefit by reading. It's citizens getting involved. That's kind of a real quick rundown of things that are going on about as quickly as I could go through it. And there she is, right there. I mentioned Amy. Okay, I know you were busy, but Amy Rowe, our chamber director, who has been a valuable asset. Also, but that's kind of a synopsis of what's happened.
I think we need to acknowledge Harry and Val we acknowledge you as a committee member. I think we need to acknowledge him.
What meeting was he at?
Yeah. Mayor, there's two more I'd like to recognize, and I'm sure I missed a lot of it, but you covered most of it. But Karen Bryant wasn't on the committee, but Jim put her to work, and she worked hours.
Oh, Karen, stand up. All right.
And the other one that we haven't really talked a lot about, the Rochester Sentinel published an article on every meth lab seizure for years. We finally figured out what the problem was. If it hadn't been for the Rochester Sentinel, this project may never have started.
Really?
Right.
Okay. Did not know that. Thank you.
That's right.
So, Wes, would you like to take a bow for the Rochester Sentinel? Wes? Really, Val, what I did note, and I should have mentioned, was all of the media in Rochester was extremely supportive. There were programs on the radio, and the Shopper's Guide, and the New Sentinel, and RTC, and Channel 4, and such. There was a lot of publicity, which, you know, it's a squeaky wheel that gets greased. I'm sure the activity at the state didn't happen because we were very meek here in the community. And actually, one of the things I'm very proud of shortly after this all culminated, and like I said, I came along at just the right time to reap some of the benefits of being involved, but I received an autographed copy of Senate Bill 80 with the inscription, "Good leadership in the city of Rochester. Keep things going, Mayor Ted." Signed, Mike Pence. So that's something that'll probably stay on the cork board for a while. Now that he's been promoted. But speaking of recognition and promotions and moving.
I will see you back at the office.
Okay, that means I'm on foot. Okay, I will be hitchhiking. Okay. Now, speaking of promotions and community involvement and citizens getting involved and actually bringing hope for advancement to our community, and that's what's happening. We're seeing a lot of people who have hope that things are changing in Rochester and that we are advancing, and that's pretty contagious. It really is, and that's what's exciting about our times right now, seeing everything happening. And for a committee to get started to do what these folks did this last year, led by a retired executive who, if you don't mind me saying it, is 90 years old. I know you hate that, but if he can do it, what can a 45-year-old do? Huh? Okay, it's a real, real inspiration to all of us. Val, would you step up here a minute? Good job. I'm breaking stride here now, and I'm going to start something on an annual basis that is brand new, but it seemed very fitting to do it at the State of the City address. I've created an award called the Mayor's Annual Citizenship Award, and we're going to have a plaque hanging in this chamber hall with the different little plaques on it saying who was the 2016 recipient in 2017 and on. And it's the mayor's choice. And someone will be chosen every year, has to be a citizen of Rochester, has to be someone who did something without getting paid for it, is a true mark of service and citizenship for our community. The first Mayor's Citizenship Award is presented to Val Pemberton, and it reads, "For outstanding citizenship and leadership in organizing the Rochester Citizens Action Committee that was instrumental in the passing of both local and state legislation to combat the illegal production of methamphetamine in the state of Indiana." Val Pemberton.
once I'm without words. Thank you.
And I thank you, ladies and gentlemen. And what better way to end a speech but by giving out an award like that to a gentleman like that? Thank you all.
Somewhere. Humanist pen portion.
Oh my gosh, thank you.
Thank you. I'd like to thank the mayor for giving the state of the city today, and thank everyone, all the officials and everyone involved for coming. I may not shave off, and I'm just glad I still have a full head of hair.
You see, there's a lot of respect. Yes.
Anything else for the good of the order?
Corey, just remind us next week, we are here. Corey,
dial 173.
Bring your phone if you have them, because we're going to use them in an interactive demonstration from the school system. So.
That's right. All right, so we're here next week, and then after that we'll be moving to the different school buildings. So come here next week and get your instructions for the weeks after. Thanks.